Arabian the Magician is not a bad detective, but he's not as good as she is. She's the brains of the outfit.
That's a bit like Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson, then, is it?
To a certain extent, yeah. If you can imagine Sherlock pontificating.
He does, doesn't he, a bit?
Well, I suppose. But Watson doing all the real hard work. For example, Michael Magister spots in the opening episode of the novel. They're outside their theatre in the Edgware Road, the Metropolitan Theatre of Steam, Smoke and Mirrors in London. And the Prime Minister has just come to see their act. And the Prime Minister is sneaking out of the theatre. And across the road, Michael sees a nanny pushing a pram along the cobbles. And it's 11 o'clock at night. And Michael says, "Look at that nanny over there. That can't be right." And Phoebe looks across and says, "Yeah, there's an unusual sight. You're absolutely right. Well spotted." And then the nanny pulls out a gun. And Michael's instinctive reaction to that is, "Oh, my goodness me, that nanny is going to shoot the baby in the pram." Phoebe says, "No, you idiot. That nanny is going to shoot the Prime Minister." So it's that kind of a dynamic.
It sounds really good. I must admit, I haven't had the pleasure of reading the novel yet, but I'm sure I'm going to get round to it.
Oh, we'll get round to it one day, but don't hurry to it. There's plenty of other good stuff to read before.
Oh, no. It has me intrigued. I, much like yourself, I have a big passion for magic. I used to watch Paul on the telly in the heydays in the 70s, and I've had the pleasure of seeing Paul, and I've met him a couple of times, and he's still the world-class magician, and he's possibly still the most underrated magician in the country and possibly in the world.
I agree with that.
His TV shows were groundbreaking, and when could you sit down and be watched by 20 million people?
Yes, exactly.
On a Saturday night. I mean, they rant and rave about this so-called show on ITV on a Saturday night, coming up to Christmas, that does, you know, make stars out of people.
Mm.
But I mean, and we've got the other one on the other side, which is the dancing show.
Mm.
I mean, I must admit, I do sway towards a dancing show. In fact, that's the only one I do watch.
Mm. Yep.
And that pulls in like 10 million viewers. Mm. And they're going on, oh, Paul Daniels used to regularly do that without really trying, without promoting the show or anything like that. And I have sitting next to me, actually, at the moment, a pack of playing cards, mm-hmm. which Paul gave me. And it's back in 19, late 70s it is somewhere, and he signed them for me. They're actually a pack of playing cards, and I've yet to master any of the tricks. My dexterity is not what it used to be.
Isn't it interesting that long forgotten, actually, was the Paul Daniels Magic Show actually won the Golden Rose of Montreux one year, which is the ultimate television accolade, and that's often forgotten. Often overlooked, and maybe deliberately so, because I think Paul is much maligned.
He's one of these people that he's a little bit like Marmite in many ways. You either love him or hate him, and those that hate him because they think he's smug. I've met him, and obviously you know him probably better than I do.
Yeah.
He's anything but that. He's such a nice man.
He's a very genuine
bloke, yeah. I mean, I've had him on the show twice, and he's a lovely, lovely guy. I've actually met him away from the radio in a dressing room somewhere, which I don't want to give too much away about that. And him and his wife are such lovely people.
Yeah, it was a good team. They're a great, Paul and Debbie are a great team in life. They're a fantastic team on stage.
Yeah, so.
This is Seclo Sounds, and you can listen to us by clicking Listen Live on our homepage at seclosounds.org for a choice of players. Via TuneIn Radio at www.tunein.com, search for Seclo Sounds and listen online or download the TuneIn app. You can download the Seclo Sounds iPhone app from the iTunes App Store, and you can listen to us on demand at our replay page.
You're listening to the Styx Radio Show here on Seclo Sounds with me, Terry Sullivan. Let's rejoin my guest, Colin Edmonds. This book I think it was the first novel published by a company called Caffeine Knights as well.
Mm, yeah, Caffeine Knights is a terrific publishing outfit down in Kent. It's a small outfit, and they specialise in crime fiction. It's a nice small stable run by a very clever entrepreneurial publisher called Darren Laws.
Mm-hmm.
Loves books. Oh gosh, he's got such a passion for books.
Yeah.
And a mutual friend of ours, a television critic, had a novel published by Caffeine Knights, and said, "You know, I'm so impressed with these guys, Cole. You should consider them for your first novel." Because I actually told Gary that I was writing this novel, and he said, "Well, rather than send it to one of the big publishing houses, you could could do worse than sending them to Darren. And sure enough, I sent the finished manuscript to Darren. And I think within 6 weeks, I got an email back saying, yes, I quite like this. I think I want to publish this. Oh, now, gosh, Terry, that's the most...
Oh, but that's a hell of a rush. That email must be good, because, I mean, you, obviously, we mentioned you've been writing for quite a few years, and you must have had some kickbacks. I mean, you must have had, you know, when you sent some scripts to people and said, this would make a great TV show, or this would be great, and people would go, forget it, you know. And I think nowadays it's even harder because of you can self-publish, you can... I know a gentleman who is an author friend of mine. He self-publishes and he puts his up on Amazon. They're on their Kindles and all, you know, the digital books and things like that. He writes detective books as well. Mm. And he said if he hadn't done it himself, he probably would not have got one published.
No, it's so tough now.
And he said what he really wanted to do, and I think perhaps you can think with this. Did you show it to your friends and family first, the book?
Oddly enough, I didn't.
You didn't. Well, he did, and all his friends said, oh, it's a great book, great book, great book. And he thought, well, let me put it up on Amazon and see how many other people brought it. Mm. And he sold 250,000 copies. So a lot of other people love his books. And, you know, and I think it's I mean, I publish a magazine. I know a lot of people know that. Mm. I publish, and it's like, to me, it's like having a baby 10 times a year.
Yes. Yes, I fully understand that.
You know, and I think you should be suitably proud of getting anything published nowadays. It's very, very difficult.
It really is. Had I sent it, Terry, to, I don't know, Random House, one of the big publishing houses, I'd still be waiting now.
Oh, God, they'd be still thinking, scratching their head.
Around from department to department. No one would want to make a decision.
Who's this guy? Oh, is he worth spending money on? Oh, I don't know, you know, yeah, I know. I must admit, over the years, I've worked for some large, very large companies, some very small companies, and of course, I now work for myself. Mm. And working for yourself is the best thing you've ever done. I wish I'd done it, I've been doing it for about 6-7 years now, and I wish I'd done it 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And I really do. And I mean, I think anybody who has an idea, or whether it be a book, a business, or anything like that, the best thing to do is follow your instincts and go for it, is what I would say to them.
Absolutely, I agree. Because otherwise you're relying on the judgment of somebody else.
Who's no idea half the time.
Yeah, exactly. That person might not be someone whose opinion you respect.
Yeah.
I had that, I think, for years in television.
Yeah.
So you'd send material, scripts, or an idea for a documentary or a sitcom or whatever to somebody, and you get a rejection letter, rather lofty normally, arch and sneering. Actually, no, unless you're David Renwick.
Yeah.
And unless you're Gortman Simpson.
Yeah.
Or Dick Clement and Lafrenne.
Yeah, or Perry and Croft.
Or Perry and Croft or John Sullivan telling me my script's rubbish. Then, actually, I'm not going to take it from you because you haven't written anything.
No. And what have you... Yeah.
That might sound me being a bitter old...
No, I think you're right. I had I met up with a singer-songwriter a little while ago, and they were very confident and said they'd written one hit single, and they knew they could write a hit single. And I very nearly turned round to them and said, why did you not write 400 like the Beatles?
Yes.
And this actually, I won't mention who it was, so I don't want to get myself in too much more trouble. And I just found that, I actually found this person almost offensive to me and to the general public, because I think nobody knows what a hit single's going to be.
No.
I mean, unless you are the Beatles or Queen or somebody like that, when they're in their height, you know, they could have released 10 minutes of silence and it would have gone to number one. But, you know, that's a different story.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, this is your first book. Any plans for the second one?
Oh, yes. I'm about 12,000 words into Steam, Smoke and Mirrors 2.
Okay. Is that what it's going to be called?
Yeah. Well, it's my shorthand. I think it's going to be called The Lazarus Curiosity.
Okay.
which tells either of us nothing.
No, well, that's nice, actually. I like reading, I must admit, I do enjoy detective books. I'm a big fan of Peter James.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, I met Peter about 3 weeks ago at his new play. He's got a new play out called Dead Simple. And I finished his book about a week ago, and I enjoyed it as much as the other 10 that I've read of his.
That's the skill, isn't it? That's why I admire novelists so much, because...
He lives around Brighton, around that area. And I've been to Brighton twice. And I tell you what, he paints such a great picture of Brighton.
Yes.
And I think that's part of it. I think if you can portray something that people don't know about and make them sort of imagine in their mind's eye that thing. Although when they make movies out of them, they often make a right mess of them.
Yeah, because the director's eye and his image of what you've imagined is completely different.
Well, I'm a big fan of Lee Charles as well.
Oh, yeah. Oh, gosh.
Jack Reacher. Marvellous. Jack Reacher. And yeah, they made a Jack Reacher film a couple of years ago. Oh, my giddy aunt.
Yeah.
Anybody who doesn't know, Jack Reacher's, what, 6'8", and he's a ex-military policeman drifter. And they got Tom Cruise, who's about 5'3", and about 2 stone wet, and he wore a leather jacket all the way through, and it was, if you hadn't read the books, it was probably a good movie, but if you had read the books, which, you know, if you're going to write Jack Reacher, the millions of fans are going to go and see it, it was atrocious.
Yeah, and that's the sadness. Once again, that spins back to your theory that actually no one knows anything.
No. Well, he was executive producer, so he got to play the part of Jack Reacher.
Yeah.
But that's, would you like your book made into a movie?
Oddly enough, you know, it started out, strictly between you and me and your listeners,
okay.
It started out as a television script.
Really?
Yeah. When I was doing less joke writing for performers, I thought, I fancy doing this magician's detective idea. I think it'll work quite nicely as a TV script. I wrote it as a TV script, and I sent it to Jeffrey Posner at Positive Productions. Jeffrey Posner is a well-known name in television because he produced Victoria Wood, produced and directed Little Britain, mm-hmm. and he's been going for years. He's a terrific producer, and his partner at Positive Productions is a great radio producer who produced most of the Radio 4 comedies, called David Tyler. Those two guys run this company. I sent my script to them, and they sent a very nice email back saying, yeah, there's something in this. Come in and have a chat. Mm. So we had a chat, and they tried to get it away for me and couldn't. The Midsummer Murders producer actually read it and sent it back saying, I'd rather like it, but I can't afford it. It's too expensive. Because it's set in Victorian times. It's got all that steam-driven stuff.
It's going to be an expensive project, isn't it? I mean,
yeah.
I mean, magic's hot again now. I mean, we've got, Jonathan Creek's been around for a little while.
Yeah.
We've got all these big sort of magic shows are suddenly appearing on TV. We've got the magicians, we've got, it's suddenly, I mean, I go around the theatre circuit and there's a load of magicians.
Mm.
Some good, some not so good. And of course you've got the clown who's the masked magician who giving the tricks away, although a lot of those, I think, and the way he was sort of doing it, I think was actually rubbish, but I discussed that with Paul, and I must admit, I'm a big magic fan, and there's nothing better than a good card, close-up magic card trick.
Yes.
You see people do it in front of you, and, you know.
But Terry, you know, I'm sure you'll agree, even if you know how the trick...
It's the technique.
Yeah.
I know how some of them have done. I've got a friend of mine who's a professional magician, a gentleman called Lee Smith, and he's never ever told me. I've had lunch with him. He's been to a private party with. He's done private parties for me. He lives locally. He lives in Hitchin. I might as well give him a big plug while I'm at it. And I sat and had lunch with him. He was doing some tricks for me, and I had no idea how they were done. But I know the techniques. I know how some of the techniques are done. But you still can't see it. You really cannot see it.
It's how they affect that practice.
Yeah, it's a craft. It really is a craft.
And of course, what we don't realise is the hours and hours of practice and application.
Oh, I know. I say, I've got this set of Paul Daniels cards I've had since the middle 70s. I met Paul in Great Yarmouth when he was doing Summer Season. And they were made by Dubrett, and he actually signed it. It's a really old picture of him. So and I've yet to manage master any of those tricks that I can to actually show anybody how they're done, which is amazing. Now, let's get away from the book for the time being. Let's go back to your early life. You as a schoolboy, you were submitting jokes to stand-up comics, and at the age of 18, you became the country's youngest situation comedy scriptwriter for Thames Television.
Yes, I did. I sent a purely on spec. I liked a show called Bless This House.
I loved it.
Starred Sidney James, great Carry On fame, and Diana Coupland.
Yeah.
And he was the head of his family. So I had the audacity to think, I'll try and write a script for Bless This House. So I wrote a 45-page situation comedy script, sent it to Thames Television. And the guy that created the series is a man called Vince Powell, who was a great sitcom writer for ITV. Wrote so many terrific shows and hit shows for them. And he sent me a letter back, say, with Thames Television headed, no paper on it. That's a thrill in itself when you get